Paris, city of lights, city of art and music and love.
And here we are, in the middle of the Seine, on the most romantic bridge in Paris. Hello, Allie.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Pont des Arts.
Or in English, the Bridge of Arts, connecting the university over there all the way over here to the Louvre.
Or excuse me, the Academy.
The Louvre used to be commonly referred to as the Palace of Arts, so why not the Bridge of Arts here?
This is definitely the most famous bridge in Paris. You have definitely heard of this bridge. This is the bridge
where all of those Parisian lovers used to come and lock their locks along the bridge.
Now you'll notice there are no more locks along the bridge here.
Well, except for the occasional remnants on any surface possible to lock anything too. Look, here's even a bike lock.
And that's because the famous Bridge of Locks used to have all those little master locks and stuff stuck to a wire mesh connected to these little walkway things.
By 2014, there were so many locks on the wire mesh of the bridge here that they had to start replacing it with these glass panels instead.
Apparently, the sheer weight of the metal locks on this old wooden bridge was threatening to destroy it.
Think about that, all that wire mesh along this entire bridge here and all those thousands of locks heavy enough to threaten the structure of the bridge.
That, my friends, was a lot of love. Now, I had grown up always hearing about this as a Paris tradition. Anytime anyone ever talked about Paris, I heard about the tradition of the lovers with the lock on the bridge. But it turns out,
according to almost everything I could read on the bridge's history,
that this tradition actually started basically around the turn of the century. You find these Paris love locks all over the city. Some of them look really old, so maybe the locking thing and then throwing away the keys so your love stays locked forever. Maybe that's a tradition.
But apparently locking them on this specific bridge is a more recent tradition. Who knew?
Anyway, we're back in Paris, so of course we had to come to the Love Lock Bridge and lock our love here.
Unfortunately, we don't have a lock, and there's nothing to lock our love too.
We'll just have to love each other the old-fashioned way without any French voodoo.
Oh, check this out over here, though. Look down in this crack. There's the key to one of the long-lost, long-removed love locks.
Allie's trying to see if she can get the key.
It's the key to love. Oh, she got it. It's the key to love.
Now, when it comes to this bridge, the locks I had heard of,
what I didn't know was that it was a wooden bridge and a seriously terrifyingly flexible wooden bridge that literally every board flexes a little bit and that you could see the River Seine down through the planks of.
I swear to you, when anyone even walks by on this bridge, you can feel the whole bridge kind of.
That's why this bridge is so romantic. After you cross this bridge together, it's like you've survived a near-death experience.
Normally, this would bother me a lot more. I'm not a huge fan of heights, but ever since I survived going to the top of the Eiffel Tower over there,
I've been feeling a little bit bolder, so that's good. Look at this. We have people selling their small paintings here. There's a guy playing the violin. Looks like people have started to graffiti a few love messages out on the glass.
And of course, there's still a few locks down here,
reminding visitors like me of the time when this was the weirdest bridge in the land.
All right, time for us to leave the bridge
and head upriver a little bit to this island you see right there in the middle of the Seine.
That right there is the Île de la Cité, and that's where we're going.
And yes, in case you were wondering, Île de la Cité means the island of the city.
Oh, check this out. Look what Allie found.
Someone has drawn this laptop here with quite a view on it. If you're watching this video on a laptop, this is probably pretty surreal. Look at this quote here. Distance is nothing but just an ordinary number.
That's beautiful. I don't know what it means, but it's beautiful.
Oh, almost off the terrifying bridge. Look at this though. Down here,
right down along the riverbank,
right underneath the Pont des Arts is this. Look at that!
Holy cow, look at all these locks that were linked to this chain that I'm assuming was for tying up boats or something in the not too far distant past. Look at this, the weight of all these locks
is actually insane.
Like, I always thought when they said that the weight of the locks on the bridge was threatening it, I always thought that was kind of like a weird excuse. No way, lift that, feel that. Just try to pull the, like, isn't that freaking heavy?
Also, insane.
Sane river, sane. Okay, never mind.
Some of these locks are engraved really fancy. Some of them are sort of antique locks. Some of them even have people's pictures on the locks.
Huh, here's another one, see? All up and down the river. People are still finding things to lock their locks to.
Ooh, and there's that super fun bridge we were on.
Somehow looking even less sturdy from underneath.
All I can think whenever I walk down here along the riverbanks, along the Seine, is of that last scene in Les Miserables where Inspector Javert shoots himself in the head
to save Jean Valjean.
What a beautiful moment. I love that movie. I love that book.
I'm even a fan of the musical.
Paris is looking a little crazy today because today, Easter, by the way, happy Easter, was the day of the color run. So every few minutes, you may notice people in the background behind me walking around with color thrown all over their clothing and their faces.
Allie and I spent the morning peacefully sleeping in on Easter.
We're not very big runners.
You may recognize these little pop-up shops along the river from such places as Epcot.
I love the idea that somebody comes to work in the morning, unlocks one of these big metal boxes,
and just sets up shop alongside the river, alongside the road, right here next to the Louvre, between the Louvre and the Ile de la Cité.
I actually never even noticed these weird green boxes in Epcot's version of France until I came to real France and then went back there.
Look at that. Allie supporting the shop.
Seriously though, look at these shops. Look how many there are.
Look at all those shops. Look how far they stretch. As far as the eye can see.
These little shops have everything. French books,
French magazines, magnets, souvenirs, and even some locks.
It's like a weird mix of CDs,
posters, magazines, trinkets, and look, even some random antiques. I think there's actually a freaking hatchet back there.
Aw, you brought me back a hatchet? How romantic.
They have everything from old drawings of vegetables to the Kama Sutra over there, to paintings, to postcards of Bob Marley.
This place has got it all.
I think Allie is in love with these little shops. Uh-oh, what do you got? Uh-oh, she's got a lock.
Now the real challenge is finding somewhere to lock the lock so that someone who works for the city can come by later and cut off the lock and get a paycheck.
Yeah.
There's some really great stuff here.
There is every possible French and Parisian souvenir in these shops.
Mini Eiffel Towers, little magnets of French bread.
And then look at this, at the end of the day, they just come over here, shut the boxes, lock them up. That's no problem since they have plenty of locks in there.
And that's it, you're off of work. That is amazing. That's amazing.
Oh, look at this, Allie.
There's a metal ring sticking out of the wall. It's perfect.
Just a quick pause so Allie can help a couple take a fun pic.
And then we can resume the ceremony.
And here we go. Locking the love forever. Locking it, locking it.
Oh, and there it is. Our love is locked forever.
Or at least, like I said, until some city maintenance worker comes along and snip.
That's probably gonna be the ultimate fate of the lock, but as the French say, c'est la vie.
Okay, we're nearing the end of the row of crazy shops.
And now, finally, here's the bridge to the Ile de la Cité.
Before we head over though, I wanna point this out. Here's a sign
pointing towards the old infamous location off yonder
of that infamous French prison, the Bastille.
And here is a sign
of that infamous French street artist, Space Invader.
Nicely done, Invader. Nicely done.
Now, speaking of French prisons, I was here last year pointing out this giant building to you. This giant building across the Seine on the island of the city right there.
That is the Conciergerie.
That right there is part of the palace of the city, which up until like the 13 or 1400s was the home of the French kings and later used as a pretty famous French prison, especially during the Reign of Terror, during the French Revolution. 13,000 people condemned to death, mostly by guillotine.
And among its other prisoners,
it was in this very building that Marie Antoinette was kept.
And if I'm not wrong, I think they kept her in there nude half the time and cut her hair really short and just humiliated her in every possible way.
Before they eventually dragged her away in an open cart to be beheaded.
Stuff like that is crazy to me, because I'm from Southern California, where most things are only about 50 years old.
Archaeologists have found remains of human habitation in this part of the city dating back to 5,000 BC. That's 7,000 years of human beings living on this island. Then, after this area was conquered by the Romans,
you know, the freaking Romans.
This island being quite strategic. Ooh, look, Eiffel Tower back there. This island being quite strategic was more and more populated
until it basically became the capital. The French kings were living on it until they moved across the river to the Louvre.
And some of the most famous churches in Paris are right over there on that island. And that is where we need to go.
You guys remember a little while ago where I mentioned Les Miserables,
which most people know as a movie or a musical, but is based on a book by Victor Hugo.
Well, we're about to take Allie to the site of another famous Victor Hugo novel.
The home of Quasimodo and the birthplace of Randomland Adventures?
What am I talking about? Oh, we'll get there in just a second, but I think
you can already tell where we're going with this.
I want to jump straight to it, but how can I pass things like this?
This clock on the edge of the conciergerie dates from about 1575.
Yeah, not 1975, not 1875, 1575.
And this guy's just the renovated version of clocks that were on this building in the 1300s.
This is where Paris's first public clocks were located.
That's how old this city is that you can point out the place where the first public clocks were put.
Think of living in this city basically when time was invented, more or less, for the mass populace. Time was invented on this corner.
That is such a beautiful clock, such a beautiful piece of history, and to think it's on the face of this building, just covering some towers that were the official offices, basically, of torture for the city.
These days, I believe that the palace of the city and the conciergerie are mostly, other than museums, used mainly as courts.
But basically, people are still being tortured here, huh? Just with lawyer bills. Different kind of torture.
It's also home to the Sainte-Chapelle,
which I believe was the king's official church when they lived down here. And these palaces, you can sort of see it peeking up above the walls.
Supposedly the most beautiful and one of the most historic churches in Paris.
And after a brief security checkpoint, we're going to try to see the inside.
Whoa, see those freaking gargoyles up there?
What an imposing edifice.
Okay, we gotta hurry.
Supposedly the last access to this church is in about 5 minutes.
So we have very little time
to linger outside. Look at all those pieces that are broken off this place.
I don't know if they're going to allow my camera inside. We'll see.
Ooh, looks like they're gonna let me with the camera, but I do see a no selfie stick sign.
This is exciting. They really hate those selfie sticks.
And here we go.
Okay, we have to be very, very quiet in here. But look at this.
The Sainte-Chapelle was finished in 1248.
1248.
I mean, this is basically a freaking medieval church.
This place is approaching 1,000 years old. And look how beautiful this is.
It was commissioned by Saint Louis.
The real Saint Louis.
The king.
This is pretty crazy, but it gets even crazier.
It's time to continue our little tour.
You know, just up this 1,000-year-old staircase.
You know, roughly speaking.
Sort of dark and gloomy and scary in here.
Oh my gosh. I just realized we have no idea where we're going, but I hope it's somewhere good.
Oh my lord.
Happy Easter, everyone.
Do you see this? Ever seen anything like this?
No.
In America?
Never.
I've never seen anything like this anywhere. Not even Las Vegas.
Look at this
place. This is the place where the early French kings came to pray.
I'm not all that familiar with the Sainte-Chapelle.
I never ever thought I would be in here. This is a total spur of the moment thing.
I have to assume that if kings were in here, probably popes were in here, saints were in here,
knights were in here, probably some knaves.
I know for a fact that a jester's been in here.
Because I'm in here. I'm in here right now.
Look at this beautiful, beautiful space. Have you ever seen anything like this in your life? Lord have mercy.
Let's go see if we can check out the altar area.
Oh, wow.
How about this? Would you look at that?
I am finding it difficult to find the words
to express how awe-inspiring this place is.
I mean, think about it this way. This place was in use before the fall of the Byzantine Empire.
This place was in use before the widespread use of gunpowder, even.
We're talking old school, chivalric knights of the round table,
Lancelot style.
Ancient human beings hanging out in here.
No electricity. No power tools when they built this.
No computers. I don't even think there was such a thing as a printing press.
And yet they were able to build this.
And you want me to be impressed with the new H&M in the mall?
This is astounding.
The carvings, the floor tiles, the wall patterns, and especially the stained glass windows. And let's not forget that insane ceiling, which I'm sure must represent heaven, because look at all of those stars.
Actually, the reason why this church is so ornate and so visual
is because it was before the printing press. A lot of times, this was the only way you could communicate
the stories of the Bible to a mostly illiterate public.
Oh my goodness. The sun just peeked out from behind the clouds a tiny little bit. The light was pouring in through the stained glass windows. Wow, what a beautiful place.
Now this building has obviously changed a lot around this chapel in the last, you know, 8 centuries.
But for the most part, they've left this intact, and you can really see why.
It's weird to me that this main chapel is located upstairs.
I wonder how normal people used to come into this church. Must have been through these large doors out here.
Like I said, the palace of the city now is used for different law courts.
There are various other high security government things going on here.
So I'm sure all this out here in the courtyard has changed many times.
But before the Louvre, this was the palace of the French kings, and this was their church. Pretty impressive.
Easily one of the most beautiful churches,
if not one of the most beautiful places, period,
that I have ever seen on this earth.
Sacre bleu! Would you look at that?
I never thought these crazy adventures would take me somewhere like this.
That is totally freaking wild.
It makes sense that you're in here, see? Because this was the Church of the French Kings, and you are a princess.
But 800 years ago, I'm pretty sure they would have stoned me.
Awesome. Totally freaking awesome.
Okay, time to put the pamphlets back and head down the creepy stairs.
Down. Don't slip.
Slipping here would be incredibly painful.
Down. And just like any other good tourist attraction,
exit through the gift shop.
Right now, Allie's buying one of these, a St. Louis Christmas ornament.
Hashtag when in Rome.
Or Paris. Okay, that was an unplanned and very unexpected, highly pleasurable treat.
That might have been the world's most beautiful church.
Okay, and now we have to go from Paris's most beautiful church
to Paris's most famous church.
Sorry for all that buildup earlier. Entering Sainte-Chapelle just threw it right out of my mind, but anyway.
Now it's time for us to go full Victor Hugo.
As we head away from Sainte-Chapelle, away from the palace of the city,
and sort of across the street to the most famous monument in Paris.
Well, at least from a literary standpoint.
It's the wonderful, the amazing,
The world famous
Cathedral of Our Lady of Paris,
or better known to tourists the world over, simply
as Notre Dame. Look at that.
Would you look at the size of that cathedral?
Believe it or not, the Cathedral of Notre Dame is actually a little bit older than Sainte-Chapelle. This place started construction in 1163.
So about 100 years before Sainte-Chapelle.
But apparently it was taking a little too long since this bad boy wasn't completed until 1345.
Sort of explains why they built Sainte-Chapelle in the meanwhile.
Look at those world famous bell towers. Can you guys see the people up there?
Probably not, since those bell towers are 226, I think, feet tall.
All again, built without any modern power tools, no giant cranes like we have now, no nothing, just stones and muscle and imagination.
Plenty of famous stuff happening here. The Pope's been in here lots of times over the years, and French kings. Napoleon was crowned emperor, well, crowned himself emperor, and his wife, in this very building.
But most important of all, let's face it, the number one uno importante thing about this place is it's the home of Quasimodo.
Notre Dame de Paris,
the Cathedral of Our Lady of Paris here, is home to none other
than Victor Hugo's infamous Hunchback.
This is where Quasimodo fell in love with Esmeralda. That up there is where he pushed Frollo down to his doom.
And I never knew until recently that the real story is so epically sad. Quasimodo's in love with Esmeralda. Esmeralda's in love with some other guy that's not in love with her.
Quasimodo loves Frollo, but Frollo's a bad guy. Frollo doesn't really love anyone. He maybe sort of wants Esmeralda. It's just, it's all bad. It's all bad news here.
Frollo dies. Esmeralda dies. The Hunchback dies.
Spoiler alert.
Everybody dies. When Victor Hugo started his book about Notre Dame, it was just called Notre Dame. He knew he wanted to write a book about the cathedral
because the place was falling into disrepair, and he was in love with the old romantic Gothic architecture. He didn't want to see this place crumble to the ground and be carted off for scrap stone,
which is why apparently in the book there's these long-winded descriptions of all the little pieces of the cathedral.
It's because the original intention of the story was as a propaganda piece to save the building,
which it did.
And now, all because of that horrific little hunchback, millions of tourists from all over the world, including some loud Americans like yours truly,
get to stand in this long line and come experience the majesty, the wonders of the 12th wonder of the galaxy,
the Cathedral of the Hunchback.
We are now part of the line, hoping to make it inside the cathedral before they close up for the night.
Police haven't cut the line yet, so we just might make it inside for a peek.
I actually filmed inside the cathedral last year
on this channel, but I'll talk about that more a little bit after we come out, if we get in.
Wow, look at those little tiny people up there.
They look like little fleas up there. Little tiny specks.
The line to go to the top, up to the bell tower where, you know, Quasimodo lived, is already closed for the day, so there's no possibility of me being terrified up there today. Thank goodness.
But it does actually look now like we are going to make it inside.
Oh yeah, we're going in.
Look at all of these hundreds and thousands of stone carved figures outside one of the three massive doors leading in here.
Okay, we're going in.
I forgot I have to take my hat off. No adventure allowed in here.
Only respect for the sacred and ancient church
of Our Lady of Paris.
Wow, would you look at that. We have to be extra quiet in here today. There is a church service happening. It is Easter Sunday.
So there are plenty of people who are actually here for worship services.
Isn't that amazing? I mean, that ceiling is, I don't know, at least 100 feet tall? And look at that over there. That altar is where Napoleon was crowned.
This place is freaking crazy.
It's so amazing and so impressive in here that my camera, at least this one, cannot do it any justice.
I honestly did not expect to get inside today.
Easter is a very big holiday for the French, so I thought this place would be packed.
Okay, we just looked it up.
The ceiling in here is 23 alleys tall, 115 feet.
I feel like that's not enough of me. I feel like it should be like
It does honestly seem like 100 alleys could stand on each other in here. But only 23 alleys.
That's crazy.
115 feet.
Last year when I came here, I had two different YouTube channels.
And I was doing two different types of videos. And my vlogs on this channel were all unedited, even if they were an hour long.
Well, some of them were, some of them weren't. But most of them were unedited. So when I came into Notre Dame, there was an active church service going on. I couldn't just run out and run around inside the cathedral unedited.
So I had to film the whole inside of this place in little clips.
And you can still go back and watch that video that I did in here showing a lot of the different side chapels, a lot of different history. I was in here with my friend Euromaestro.
Anyway, when it was all said and done, we then spent an hour walking around the outside of the cathedral unedited. And it was at that point I realized it was so completely frustrating
to come somewhere this epic that I never thought I would come back to again for the rest of my life.
And feel like having the two channels was actually taking away from my ability to show all the cool little things to and from places like this. But especially,
the format was taking away from my ability to actually showcase these places.
Like, as much as I love the hyperness and the wackiness and the insanity of all the unedited stuff,
once I left Notre Dame last time,
you could see in that video the inside portions of the cathedral were so much better than the outside portions of that video.
And as I was walking around outside looking up at the gargoyles that I couldn't film because it was all unedited,
even as I was filming and talking to my friend Euro out there, the idea for Randomland Adventures was being born in my brain.
And so now, not only is this just the place where the Pope comes to hang out,
and where Napoleon and his wife were crowned Emperor and Empress,
this is also the place Randomland Adventures was born.
Look at this, guys. Look at this. Would you look at the size of this holy space?
Holy cathedral, Batman.
Pretty crazy stuff. Crazy to think that the oldest parts of this church
are almost 1,000 years old.
900 years. That's the same age as Yoda.
All right, as you can imagine, there's plenty more to see in here.
But if we keep filming in Notre Dame, we won't have time to show you anything else today in Paris.
But how can we not at least take a peek inside the treasury? Of course, they're out of the English guide paper, so we cannot tell what we're looking at. But it looks very treasure-ish indeed.
These, I know, are Napoleon III's baptism robes. I mean, that is pretty crazy right there. The robes of an emperor.
Lots of vestments and sacred vessels in here.
Beautiful architecture inside of this place. This wasn't open last time I was here.
Various holy books and bishops' mitres.
Whoa.
And this is where they keep the rich stuff.
Look at all of this crazy swag. And right there is the bone of a martyr.
I do not know what this particular chapel is called,
but this is totally freaking cool. Look at that little window. It's open.
I didn't know stained glass windows could open. I learned something.
Look at all this gold.
And look up there. Look above the cross. If you sort of squint, you can see circle, circle, circle. Hidden Mickey. Hey. It's not much more of a stretch than some of the ones I've heard at Disneyland.
Look at this, ancient manuscripts.
Pieces from imperial processions and saints' reliquaries. I have no idea what that is.
The world's most giantest music stand?
Check out this statue of Saint-Denis.
Good old Saint Denis, the patron saint of France, got his head cut off, walked around, and carried it up to the hill of Montmartre. All by himself.
It's a long story.
But any guy who can carry his own head around town deserves our respect.
Okay, as amazing as this is, it's time for us to head out. There's all kinds of relics back there. Relics of saints and pieces of the true cross and pieces of the crown of thorns and crazy things.
It would just take days to film all the stuff here.
And it's beautiful and mind-blowing and breathtaking. As the inside of the cathedral is. We don't have days.
Because as much as I want to look at the spot where Napoleon was crowned,
to be completely honest with you, I have got to go to the bathroom.
But I really want to put my hat back on.
Because I kind of look like a crazy person.
Okay. Outside again.
With my hat.
All right, guys. You know how much I love you.
But this is where we have to say goodbye, because I didn't bring an extra memory card. And that's it.
We're full!
So as the bells toll the hour here at the Cathedral of Notre Dame,
we must bid you all adieu.
Au revoir, everyone. And happy Easter.
Goodbye.
Au revoir.